Welcome to The Word This Week. I'm Rachel Giza. You may not have heard of Ken Nordine, but you've certainly heard his voice. As one of the leading broadcast, radio, and commercial announcers in the United States, Nordine has hawked everything from Taster's Choice coffee to Levi's blue jeans. But there's more to Nordine than that. He was a contemporary of the Beat Poets, and in the 1960s, he pioneered his own form of spoken word with his word jazz recordings. On this very special edition of The Word This Week, we take you inside the strange and exciting world of Ken Nordine.
I was listening to the radio sometime in the 60s, probably in Chicago, and a really strange voice came on, and it was unlike anything I ever heard.
If you grew up in Chicago, he's a legendary figure.
In my mind, Ken is locked as some sort of late night, 4 o'clock in the morning voice that creeped me out, you know, but in a good way.
I always think Ken's like Minnesota Fats, you know, that he came into town with his voice, you know, and that, you know, he won a few games, you know, and then he worked his way across the country using his voice, you know, like, you know. And there's something so unforgettable about it. It's almost like listening to Nat King Cole or Sinatra or something. Once you've heard it, you say, oh, that's Nordine.
I got into conversation with Jerry Garcia about Ken Nordine. And when I found out that he was a big fan of Ken Nordine's, things started to click. And I realized that what Ken was and is a link between the Beat generation, the hippie generation, and today's coffee house literature, poetry, jazz, you know, kind of movement.
I'd like to tell you how things are with me. I have to go back away to do it. I was born in a very small town in Iowa, Cherokee, Iowa, population 5,000 then. Well, that's a lie. Actually, there were only 3,000 people in the town. But the state insane asylum was on the hill, and it was civic pride that made us add the other 2,000 so that when you drive in, it would say 5,000.
Girls would hear me on the phone. They said, you should be in radio. And of course, that, you know, was beautiful. That my testosterone nature immediately grabbed hold of that and figured that, hey, thank you. And I'd start to recite poetry on the phone, figuring it would be a plus, you know, that we can go out on a date. But from that, I decided.
You're a charmer.
I decided I'd go into to radio. From the very beginning, I loved voices. I used to listen to Orson Welles and think, oh gosh, he's wonderful. And Rod Serling. And I thought, my, this is the thing to do. I was going to be a concert violinist at one time. Fortunately, I decided not to do that. I didn't have to rosin my throat or buy strings for my larynx. I could just talk.
But then, on a Thursday of a year, who can remember except Blue? Something sudden happened.
I did a thing early on television called Faces in the Window. And that was, it went on for about a year and a half on NBC. This is way back, 1957. I did a little show that was reading Poe or Balzac or Dostoevsky. And it was just me in a very dim light with the script of the book in front of me. I talked to young people later on who said, you used to listen to that. And what it turns out, the kids would listen to it in front of their old little black and white television set way back when they were young. And it was a great excuse to hug and kiss in the dark because they were supposed to become so frightened by what was going on. So I probably contributed to population growth.
Wonder where I'm going. I don't know where I've been. I'm on my way to somewhere. You know, I hope they let me in.
I came back to Chicago and got a job at CBS. I started working doing using my regular name at night. But, you know, when you're young, even though you have a lot of fear sometimes, I decided, well, I'll go freelance and I'll do all the things that they tell me to do. I did slide films, I did spots, I did whatever the traffic was there, and made a good living doing it. Also at that time, I met Jim Cunningham, who is still alive, a wonderful, wonderful engineer. And he and I used to do things in a basement in Highland Park, which always struck me as funny, where there was all kinds of equipment. In fact, we did a thing together called Sounds of Space.
I wonder if the other end of the celery tastes good. The top end tastes as good as the bottom end.
That's where I did Hunger Is From, in the basement at Highland Park. I was hungry, had a plate of something, we were recording very close sounds, so we get this very strange exaggeration of sound. And that was where Weird Jazz began. They called me from the West Coast to do something for Dot Records, Shifting Whispering Sands, which was a choir, you know, was singing behind it. It's about this old Western guy, and it was a hit. Dot Records did very well, and then they decided, can you do anything else? This has done very well. So I said, well, I've done these things in the basement that I call Word Jazz. And they said, well, hey, we'll put those out.
I think it was fertile ground, the whole idea of putting words and music together, the spoken word with music, and Ken was right at the vanguard of that, you know, so I think, you know, he was right in there.
You realize that they're just these little paintings, really, of life in America.
I think with his voice, especially with the old Word Jazz albums, he wasn't singing and he wasn't even rhyming. His words were sort of dancing with the music, or maybe the music were dancing with his words.